I would like to thank the organizers for this wonderful workshop, which is extremely well arranged, and I think we all have a great time here. It's also great to be able to present in Moscow. So today we'll talk about research which was mainly joint work with Remco. And so myself, I work at the University of Twente in Stochastic Operations Research Group, and for the last several years I work on the analysis of complex networks, mainly interested in algorithmic aspects of it, and actually how the algorithms work, and what kind of results they produce, and what can we expect from these results, and how informative these results are about the network structure. So we all know that networks are characterized by power law, but this is not enough. It is obviously very important how the network is wired and who is linking to whom. And as an illustration, I like this picture. So this is an internet graph, like network of routers connected by links. This is an Abelian network that resembles very much the real internet graph. And this is a network of bank transactions between major banks. And you can see that obviously these two graphs are wired completely differently. So if in the internet you see a dense mesh in the middle and hubs all on periphery, so actually hubs, the nodes of large degree are not even very important nodes. And obviously failure of a hub will not damage the network significantly. Then in the network of bank transactions, most of transactions go via the biggest banks, and these hubs are right in the center. And obviously if big bank fails, as we were listening 2 days ago about the contagion of financial crisis, then obviously it will have a huge effect on the whole network. So, but how can we characterize how the network is wired? How can we compute it and characterize it with some number? So, already some time ago, Newman came up with this measure. I mean, this is a measure for so-called degree-degree correlation. This is the first thing that you would like to know. Other nodes of large degrees usually connect to nodes of the large degrees, or the other way around. So then, if you have a network, and this is node I, and this is node j, and these nodes I and j are connected by an h, and this is degree of the node I, and this degree of the node j, then what you would like to do is to measure correlation between these two values. So what is the correlation between the degrees of the neighbors? And the neighbors connected by an arbitrary h. So formally, we can describe it as follows. Consider an undirected graph, and we always use this E prime for directed edges. So basically, E prime is double the E, and in E, we have just H connected to nodes, and in E prime, there will be two edges from one node to another and back. Okay, so we will denote nodes by V, and then the assertivity measure, rho G, where G is a graph, was proposed by Newman as follows. So if you look at this, it is nothing else but just Pearson correlation coefficient. So what we have here? Here we have summation over all directed edges, and these are the products of the degrees on two sides of this directed edge. And here I used small letters, but here I use capital S, but doesn't matter. So we have this cross product, and here is like average cross product of the degrees of the neighbors. Okay, then what do we have here? Well, obviously degrees of the nodes, they all have the same distribution. So here we have nothing else but just an expected degree squared. And here we have a second moment of the degree, and here we again have expected degree squared. So we all easily recognize the standard Pearson correlation coefficient, the covariance divided by variance. Well, usually it is covariance divided by product of standard deviations, but here, because distribution of dv and dw is the same, then you will have just variance in denominator. Everything is fine, and we know that this sort of measure does reflect the dependencies. It's very standard. So then why not to use it? So people started using it intensively, and this paper has, like, I think, I don't know, I, yes? Yeah, you see, if you don't double, then obviously the result will be the same, but it will be useful for us for analysis, formalization of the analysis is easier in this. Because basically, why I can tell you, because an H which is a part of E prime is a vector u, like v w. You have the first coordinate v, second coordinate w, and this is an h from v to w. If you just have an h, then it's not a vector, it's like a set. So formally it's more difficult to deal with, that's it. So because I want my h's to be described as vectors, and that's why. Okay, so then this is all very standard, and Newman used it to compute dependencies in all sorts of different networks. And this is a table that you probably don't see very well, but he this all different examples of the networks, he split it in social, technological, including internet, World Wide Web, and biological. And what he figured out that social networks are mostly assortative, meaning this correlation coefficient is positive. So nodes with large degrees tend to connect to nodes to large degrees. And technological networks tend to be disassortative, so this coefficient is negative and there is a negative correlation. However, so this was a conclusion and it's a very highly cited paper. However, what we can notice that when we look at the numbers that we obtain here, then we see that once network is a little bit bigger, like this worldwide web sample, then immediately the coefficient becomes very small. And in fact, in many other papers, we never see networks with strong negative correlations, which is a funny thing, because why not? I mean, is it not possible to have a large disassortative network? So apparently the reason is in this measured row, and this I will explain. And actually it was noticed by a number of people, like Sergei, who is sitting here, or not sitting here anymore, I don't know, yes, here. Yeah, so Sergei was one of the people who investigated that, but there were also other people who noticed that actually something is wrong with this coefficient in the sense that it can never be strongly can never give you a large negative number. Okay, so why is that? I can explain it very briefly. So first of all, if we do this summation, we can easily write this such as a sum over edges as a sum over vertices. Except here, when we sum over edges, then every vertex is counted as many times as its degree. And that's why we have here degree squared. Similarly, when we try to find the expectation of second moment over edges, then and rewrite it in terms of summation over vertices, we obtain a third moment here, the sum of third powers. And then when we rewrite this assertivity coefficient in these terms, then what we will see that we will have this third powers in the numerator. Okay, so why is it bad? Because we have power laws. And power loss, as we already discussed, is roughly that our proportion of nodes with degree k is roughly some constant multiplied by power of k. And that gives us high variability. Some people argue that power laws don't really exist, but actually power loss is nothing else but just a model for high variability. So Remco already mentioned that we can describe this power loss formally like this. So in this sense that we can describe the distribution of the degree as some slowly varying function, you can think of a constant or a logarithm, multiplied by the power of x. Okay? So, and then for this regular variation, a lot of results are known. And we know more or less how the sums or the powers or the maximum values of regular varying random variables will behave. In particular, for instance, from the extreme value theory, we know how the highest order statistics behave. So for instance, if we consider independent regular variant random variables and we look at the order statistics, and for instance, look at the maximum value, then what we can do, we can scale them properly, centralize and scale them properly, and then this number will converge to a certain non-trivial distribution. Very roughly, you can say that this scale an, is roughly of the order, or I'm sorry, here is capital N, should be small n, roughly of the order n to the power 1 over gamma, where gamma is a power law. But it doesn't mean that this degree is, it doesn't necessarily mean that degree is some constant multiplied by this power of n. Why not? Because the convergence is, like in CLT, it converges to a random variable. So there is still a lot of randomness in that, but at least this is the correct scale. Similarly, we have a central limit theorem for power laws, for regular variant distributions. And this central limit theorem says that if you scale the sum of the powers of regular variant distributed random variables properly, and actually it's the same scale as in the case of extreme values, then again you will obtain a convergence. In this case, it will converge to a stable law. And stable law is also a heavy tail distribution. And so again, the sum scaled properly will converge to non-trivial limit, and it will converge to some random variable. So we can already see that something funny is going on, that the sums don't scale like n. I mean, we, in a light case scenario, when you sum up n random variables, and according to law of large numbers, it will just scale as n. But here, because if p greater than gamma, then expectation of xp doesn't exist, then you don't have the scaling proportionally to n, but you have a scaling which is a larger power of n than 1. Power n p over gamma, which is larger than 1 if p is greater than gamma. So that means that our normal convergence, what we are used to when we are talking about the sum, simply doesn't hold here. So, and what happens actually, so if we write this rho as like cross products of the degrees minus expectation squared divided by variance, then we can always look only at this part, expectation squared divided by variance. The beauty is that in this negative part, the variance is not important. It's only degree distribution that plays a role here. It doesn't matter how the network is wired. We are only talking here about the degree sequence. And what happens here, that here we have the sum of the degrees squared, and here we have the sum of the degrees to the third. And because of this, and then when our gamma is very heavy-tailed, then this will grow at much faster pace. The denominator will grow much faster than numerator, and denominator will just kill everything. So the negative part will go to zero. So informally, this is what is going on. So basically, because the third power grows at least like this, because the third power is at least the maximum number to the power 3, so the maximum number scales as n to the power 1 over gamma, so this third power scales like that. And because we also know the scaling for the second powers, we can prove that for gamma between 1 and 3, which are the realistic values of gamma, this denominator will always grow much faster than numerator. So it means that whatever negative contribution you had, it will just vanish. So there is no wonder that we have actually never observed strong negative correlations in large networks, in large scale free networks. This is because of this third powers here. Can we conclude that any large scale-free graph is never disassortative? Of course not. It's just an artifact of the measure, yes?
So gamma is in this interval for those actual networks?
Yes,
for which?
Yes. For most real-life networks, gamma is. So but that basically means finite expectation that we usually observe, and then either infinite variance or finite variance but infinite third moment. Well, infinite third moment is reasonable for most of the networks. Even infinite variance we observe very often. Very often we observe gamma between 1 and 2, actually. And then still this result will hold. So basically the theorem is that if our degrees are scaling according to the same laws as the scaling for regular variant distributions, so that their maximum scales as n to the power 1 over gamma, and their sum of the second powers are scaling, well, as 2 over gamma if second moment exists, or as n if second moment doesn't exist. So in all these scenarios, we always have that the limit of assertivity coefficient in the infinite size, in the infinite volume limit, is always non-negative. So Yeah, so then it means that this measure simply is not suitable for measuring this assertivity in scale-free graphs. Okay, then what can we do? So alternatively, we can use rank correlations. And rank relations are working as follows. Assume this graph, and or this should be E prime, set of directed edges. So then we can introduce ranks of the degrees where this edge is chosen uniformly at random. Well, immediately you can say that they will have a lot of ties. Why? Because we are considering edges. So then if we had this node, say V, and it had several edges, and each of the edges will be considered. So at least dV times, we will observe the number dV. So we, by definitions, we have a lot of ties. Okay, so we chose to resolve the ties uniformly at random. And in fact, it means that to the degree, we just add a uniformly distributed random variable. And then the order of this degrees will be random. Okay, so then instead of actual degree, we consider degree plus some uniform random variable u, and we denote by f star distribution of this random variable. Okay, so what we used in our work with Remco is Spearman's row as rank correlation, and that works like this. So we have here a set of directed edges. We look at the ranks of this randomized degrees, and we look at the uniformly chosen edge, and we define the Spearman's row as a correlation coefficient, but not the correlation coefficient between the actual values of the degree, but the correlation coefficient between the ranks. Okay, so here again we have cross products, and then ranks, we know we have values from 1 to the size of E prime, so we will have E prime values. E prime plus 1 divided by 2 will be average rank, so this is expectation squared, and we also can compute variance, and this is the variance. So this is the formula for the Spearman's row. Okay. Now, why does it help us? Well, because the ranks are just actually uniform random variables scaled by the number of directed edges. So the number of edges will cancel everywhere, and we will have some reasonable number. In particular, we can also obtain a negative number here. The negative part will not vanish. So in this sense, it does solve the problem. And actually, the fact that you should apply rank correlation in this setting is known for a really long time. It's a classical fact. It's already in the 30s that Hotling and Pabst, when they started this rank correlation, they said that if we know, especially if we know that our observations come not from a normal distribution, then always rank correlations are preferable to Pearson correlation coefficient. In fact, Pearson correlation coefficient is only working for normal distributions. So it is a classical measure. Okay, now, but the whole point of introducing rank correlations was actually to have a consistent estimator. What do you mean by consistent estimator? It means that the estimator that will converge to a correct value, whatever it is, a correct value, when your graph size goes to infinity. Graph size going to infinity means that you're getting more and more data points, right? So consistent estimator is the estimator that actually produces for you an estimate of some parameter, a statistical estimation of some parameter, and when your data size grows, this estimator should converge to the right value, and naturally the variance should decrease. Right? And what we observed that for this Pearson coefficient, what we saw that for heavy tail degrees just converges to zero, as if it is measuring zero, or it just at least converges to something on negative, and maybe we want to measure something negative. So this is a theorem that states that provided that this condition is satisfied, our rank correlation is actually consistent estimator, our Pearson correlation coefficient. So it will converge to a value which will be a correct value on the population. Why is this? Why is this number? So you can notice easily that ranks have a lot to do with empirical distribution. So the rank RV is the number of nodes in let me see, the number of rather ages in E prime, such that the one of the n's is equal to v, that degree, I don't know, I'm worried too, I'm very nervous, so I'm really sorry. So this is the number of ages in E prime such that degree of this is greater than degree of V, right? So this will be great, yeah. Yeah, and then plus one. So you basically, you count how many of degrees are larger than yours, and then you add the one, and that will be your rank. So, but this is nothing else, so you just count how many values larger than your values you have, right? So this is, if you divide this by the number of ages, then it will be nothing else but empirical probability to obtain a degree on the end of the age greater than what you see, right? So it has everything to do with empirical distributions, but empirical distributions will converge to actual distributions. So that's why this will be the correct value, and this coefficient 12 here is obtained because in the limit, these random variables are uniform random variables. We use this fact a lot because distribution function of a random variable applied to the same random variable always has a uniform distribution, so its variance will be 1 over 12. So you divide by 1 over 12, and it gives you coefficient 12 here. So basically, with rank relation, you have empirical distributions. They will converge to actual distributions, and the variance will be 1 over 12, which will give you a coefficient. So we can prove that if you have, so under this condition, we have a rank relation always converges to the correct value, the population value. Okay. But the question is now, what is this condition? So actually, this expectation here is a random variable. And here we say, it's like, okay, we have a continuous and bounded function h, and then we compute the value of this function h on a graph of size n. So for each graph, we will have a different value. And the condition is that this expectation, when n goes to infinity, will converge to some constant. Okay. So in addition, we say if the second moment exists of the degrees on the two sides of random edges, then Pearson correlation coefficient also will converge to constant. But that's not the most important thing. So, and then actually, the equivalent condition to this condition is the following. That is much easier to verify. So it is simply if you count the number of ages such that degrees are equal to certain values, and if you define it, divided by the number of ages, so this fraction has to converge to some proper two-dimensional probability distribution. So basically what you want in your sequence of random graphs, the condition that you impose, is if you look at a random age and you took at the degrees on the left and on the right, then this two-dimensional vector will converge in distribution to something proper, to a proper distribution. And that is a very natural assumption to ask. If you want anything to converge on a graph, then you want this to converge, of course. Okay, so the proof, I have put a small sketch, but the idea of the proof is that because we have this, so if we define by xn a degree on one end of random age, we know, we impose a condition that converges to distribution to something, to the proper random variable, and then here we just use the fact that the ranks are nothing else but empirical distributions, and we use the fact that this distribution functions are, so that this distribution function is continuous. So when we use basically continuous mapping theorem. And because we are dealing with discrete distributions, we can say that convergence is uniform. And also we use the fact that these two random variables where X star is just basically this, a degree plus uniform random variable, that these random variables are uniform random variables. I don't know, this is probably a standard fact that everybody knows, that if a random variable X has a distribution F, X, then random variable fx of x is uniform on 0, 1. So this is a fact that we use a lot. So basically, there is nothing else but just interpretation of ranks as empirical distribution, and the fact that empirical distribution, limiting distribution, is continuous, and then we use continuous mapping theorem, and we use this uniformity of this random variables. That's it. Okay, so then we want to apply this result, and we considered this result on several random graph models. So the first was the configuration model. So the configuration model, here we have a certain realization of the degrees, the small d's, and everybody knows how this configuration model looks like. So we have the nodes, and some node has degree d1. Of this half ages, we give the first node d1 half ages, second node d2 half ages, etc. And here some other node with say dk half ages, and some last node with dn half ages, and then we start just connecting these sub half ages uniformly at random. Sometimes we have self loop. Loops arising, because sometimes we can just by chance connect node to itself, and sometimes we have double ages arising. For instance, we can by chance connect this node twice, these two nodes twice to each other, but that happens rarely, and we just erase those. Okay, so in configuration model, we demand additional conditions. So first of all, we require that distribution of the degrees converges to a proper distribution. Second of all, we require also convergence of expectations. We have to require it separately because it doesn't follow from convergence distribution. So, and then under this condition, we can prove that both Pearson and Pearson correlation coefficient and Spearman's row both converge to zero. And that is, of course, very natural because configuration model is a model of independent connections. So you can expect that if your network is wired independently, it's like sort of a sanity check model, then your correlation coefficient, of course, has to go to zero. Okay, and what we actually need to prove is, if I go back, so we need to prove actually that this condition holds, and that we just do by estimating the number of ages that satisfy this condition, and then we use the second moment method to show the convergence. Okay. So, and these are the plots. I will show many of those, so you can look at the first scenario. So, what are these plots? They are scatter plots that results from simulations of the graphs. So here I simulated twenty times configuration network of 100 nodes, 20 times of 1,000 nodes, 20 times of 10,000 nodes, and 100,000 nodes. And here the blue dots are the Pearson correlation coefficient, the assertivity coefficient, and the red dots are the rank correlations. So the blue are the bad guys and the red are the good guys. And then what we see that, of course, both of them go to zero. We can say, well, maybe red goes a little bit faster, but that doesn't really matter. They both go to zero. So this is what you would expect. But then we wanted to check how it works on really, really strong correlations. Strong negative correlations. And to create a graph with strong negative correlation, we introduce the following model. We take our configuration model as before, like connected at random, and then what we do, on each edge, we introduce a new vertex, and now there is no HST, but there is an HSU and UT. So now all original nodes in our original network are connected to something of degree 2. So we expect that this network has to be disassortative because all the big guys are now connected to the nodes of degree 2. Okay, so we can compute what assertivity coefficient will be, And then actually based on this computation, we can prove the following theorem. So this is a little bit more computation. So in this particular model, we can actually compute what the rank relation will converge to. Here this Gn bar is our configuration model with intermediate vertices, and Gn is the original configuration model. So we can prove that this rank relation will converge to this number. And of course, your assertivity coefficient will also converge, but only if the third moment of degrees exists, which is a very, very strong condition. Usually the third moment will not exist. Okay, now let me look a little bit at this formula before I show you simulations. So here what we can notice that we have -3/4 and plus something non-negative, where this P1 bar is a probability computed by this. And basically what it is, so if you are in this configuration model of intermediate vertex, and you are here, and you choose an arbitrary edge, for instance, you choose this edge, and you look left and right. On one side, you always see a vertex of degree 2. On the left side, you can see vertex of degree k, but the probability will not be pk, so it will not be the fraction of nodes of degree k, but it will be this probability because each node of degree k will have, of course, k edges. So, and because we are looking at the edges, this node has to be counted now in this case 4 times. So that's why this is sort of size bias distribution. So pk tilde here, size bias distribution. So, so first of all, if in our original graph, P1 was 0, so here was 0, and P2 was 0, then P1 tilde and P2 tilde are also both zeros. So then this whole thing will disappear, and we will have a correlation -3/4. And that's the strongest you can get. Why? Because of the random resolution of ties. Because we have many ties, and when we resolve them at random, we introduce some sort of independence. So we really cannot get correlation -1. Okay, but also the nice thing about this formula is that this particular term will become maximum when we have, let me erase this, when we have p 1 tilde plus 1/2 p 2 tilde is 1/2. Then in this case, it will be maximum. This product actually will be 3/4, and the whole thing will be 0. Okay? But then what does it mean? It means that P1 tilde is nothing else but 1/2, 1 minus P2 tilde. So it means that in our original configuration model, whatever vertices didn't have the degree 2, they had either 1, either degree 1, or some other degree. And when you choose an edge, then in half of the cases, you will see degree 1. And the other half of the cases, you will see degree higher than 2. And sometimes, maybe you will see degree 2. But that exactly means that the correlation is 0, because the vertices of degree 2 will be connected either of the vertices of the same degree, or in half of the cases to degree 1, or in other half of the cases of higher degree. So then you expect the 0. So, and that's why, that is a nice thing about this formula. And this is just following from straightforward computation and is only true when the third moment is finite, which is a very strong condition. Yeah, I'll finish, don't worry. Okay.
I had a question.
Yes?
So -3/4 is the smallest correlation you can get for configuration model.
No, the, for
configuration
this
configuration model for your split edges.
Vertices, yeah.
But can you construct graphs where the correlation is goes to -1 for rank correlation?
Yes, we did it for directed case. If I have time, I will mention it at the end. But if you have this random resolution of ties, then of course it introduces some randomness and some independence. So in this case, in this particular scenario, this what doesn't make it -1. Otherwise, it would have been possible. Yeah, and then I really like this picture. So they are talking about the graph. So here in this particular scenario, you see -0.75. So it means that in this graph, in original configuration model, all nodes were degree 3 and higher. Okay? And what we see here, this is how your assertivity behaves. So for graphs of different sizes, it will go to zero and it will never, actually will never be able to go higher than this number, which is the largest negative number that can be. And it will also go to zero. But now look how our rank relation behaves. Not only it's completely consistent for all graph sizes, also as a good statistical estimator, it becomes, the variance becomes less and less. So this is really something that we want to have for a good statistical estimator. How much time do I have?
5 minutes.
Okay. Okay, so we also analyzed the preferential attachment model with this attachment mechanism. So when at time at t plus one, a new vertex comes into the picture, and then it connects to one of the existing vertices with this probability. So this is the current degree of a vertex, v, and this is, and then we have some additive factor delta, some additive term delta here. So this was studied, the correlations in such networks were studied by Sergei Dragovtsev and by Evgeny Grechnikov, who presented yesterday about directed scenario. Okay, so here is the theorem that we proved, so we couldn't apply these results directly. So this formula actually comes from Sergei's paper, but there they just wrote the balance equation in the limit, and then they derived this, but we had to prove that you can actually pass to the limit. So the Evgeny's results were close, but we couldn't use them directly, so we basically reproved it. What it says that we have the certain values of delta, again, when the third moment exists, then you will have convergence to this row, and otherwise you will have convergence to zero of the assertivity coefficient, and the rank relation will always converge to correct value, which unfortunately we couldn't compute, because the calculations becomes very messy and you cannot obtain an analytical expression for this. Okay, and these are the results. So for particular scenario with delta equal to zero, we have again for assertivity, the blue scatter plots, we have again convergence to zero, and we have again very consistent results for rank relations. And we see that they're negative, which maybe can be explained by the fact that when you have a large vertex, that most of the guys that attach to this large vertex are small vertices of small degrees. Okay, now. So far, we have considered this scenario when this third moment is so much dominating that the whole fraction goes to zero. It's not necessary. We can come up with an example where this term is of the same order of magnitude as this term. And then what will happen? So apparently, even if this fraction doesn't converge to zero, it doesn't really help you, because it will converge to a random variable. And we constructed the following example. Assume we have this IID regular variant random variables, X, Y, I, and Y, I. And we create, and these random variables are linear combination of some other random variables, which are also regular variant. So we have linear dependencies between X and I. And then what we do, we take X vertices on one side, Y vertices on another side, and we create a complete bipartite graph between the two sides. And then we create a collection of n such bipartite graphs. And we want to know the correlations in this system. Obviously, when you have only one of these graphs, you have larger number of degrees on the left, a larger number of nodes on the left, and small number on the right, for instance, then you have negative correlations. But when you have many of them, then this positive linear dependence will kick in, and when your number of graphs is really large, then you will see that those graphs who have many nodes on the left will have also many nodes on the right, so you have, because there are complete bipartite graphs, you will have positive correlation of the degrees. Okay. So then what? Then we try to consider what the limit will be of this graph, and we see that Pearson correlation coefficient in this case converges to a random variable which lives on this interval for a greater than one. So in particular, for instance, if a is equal to two and b is equal to, a is equal to two, then you will have here 4/5. So you will have a correlation coefficient. So what does it mean? So it means that you create a network using a certain mechanism. You measure correlation coefficient. Then you create another network, very large, with the same mechanism, and you measure it again. What you hope that the correlation reveals you something about the mechanism. So you hope that if you have two huge networks like preferential attachment, and you create them with the same mechanism, and you measure correlation here and there, you will obtain something similar. And this is what we saw in the plots before. But what will happen here, that you create huge network using this mechanism, this collection of bipartite graphs, then you use the same mechanism and create another collection, you measure correlations here and there, and they will be just different. They will be just different. So, and every time you reproduce the experiment, you will obtain something else, because in the limit you have a random variable. So this is a very undesirable property for a statistical estimator. And definitely this is not what we want to see. And this is why you have to be so careful with this Pearson correlation. Even if you don't, even if you have a number, it doesn't mean this number means something. Okay, here we get some experiments, and my favorite is this one. It is a UK crawl of 100,000 nodes and 1 million nodes, and just look what happens. So you see that Pearson correlation here is much larger than here, is negative, large negative value, but for bigger crawl, it just disappears. Probably you hit a couple of big web pages, and denominator kills everything. But what happens here for uncorrelations, they are very consistent. Of course, the data is not always so nice to you, so I was really happy, but I hope you can see the point. So the rank correlation really behave better. Okay, so I had like this work continues. I have a very bright student who also is analyzing this on directed networks. Probably I will have to skip that, but the point is that in directed networks you have four different types of correlations, and then for all four you have different behaviors. So these are the values of power exponent, where your correlation will converge to a non-negative number. And for all different four types you have different areas. So, which is natural, because in the directed scenario, for instance, if you have this age, and you want to measure correlation. For instance, you want to measure correlation between out degree here and in degree here. Then this age will participate in both out degree here and in degree here, and then you will obtain exactly the scenario as we had an undirected case. But if you have, for instance, if you want to measure in degree here versus in degree here, then this age will participate in degree here, but it will not participate in degree there. And that's why you get this all four different scenarios. And also we came up with an example, what David just asked, we came up with an example where Pearson correlation converges to plus one, and Spearman converges to minus one. So they can also totally disagree. And that brings us to the question, actually, is rank correlation really a huge solution for the problem? It is a solution in a sense that it gives you provably consistent estimator. While assertivity, this Pearson coefficient, simply is not consistent, so should not be used. However, rank correlations, what do they measure? So this fine example appears, for instance, when you have two nodes which are huge, and then they will dominate your Pearson, but rank relation makes everybody equal. So instead of having some huge value, you just have rank one. And then the rest small nodes will dominate completely, and if these small nodes happen to have negative correlation, then they will dominate your rank relations. But we do want to know something about hubs, and in this sense, rank relations are too democratic. They are consistent, all right, and on the data, for instance, my students did a computation of Wikipedia data, they give very reasonable results, but still, do they give the answers that we want? So that was more or less what I wrote in the conclusion, that rank correlation is a big step forward in the sense of consistency, but not yet in the sense of characterizing network structure. So definitely we will continue this research, and I hope that one time I will have a chance to come and talk more about it. At the moment, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Okay, we do have time for questions. Anybody? Yes?
Do you believe that degrees of nodes are really heavy tail?
Okay, if you formulate the question like this, heavy tailed, yes. I believe it. Because heavy tail is nothing else as a model of high variability. It means there is a fraction, a visible fraction of huge nodes that change the behavior of network. Yes, I believe it. And we saw this change in behavior. How the
I also believe it. Then the next question, how heavy?
I do believe that that in many cases infinite variance is a very reasonable model. Whether it is exactly power law, I don't think so. But in this sense, regular variation gives you enough flexibility because it has this slowly varying coefficient, so it offers already a lot of flexibility.
So in this case, correlation is meaningless if you believe variance is infinite.
Exactly, and that's exactly the point, but it has been used a lot. My paper is cited much less than their paper. Yeah.
There are many measures of dependence, especially for heavy tailed.
Yes, so the rank relation.
I would recommend to use these values. I just want to recommend you to read some papers of Sidney Resnick about the autocorrelation function.
Yes.
How it behaves even if the fourth moment is infinite.
Yes, I know the work of Sid Resnick, and in particular we used, for instance, angular measure, one of his techniques to measure dependencies between page rank and degrees of a node network. But we didn't come yet so far of doing, for instance, angular measure in this scenario. And why? Well, we could probably have computed it, but we wanted to do the analysis. So the analysis we did for this rank relations, and also angular measure is a difficult technique to explain. There, basically, you characterize dependence not by a number, but by a function. And this is more difficult to comprehend. So people usually want a number. And in this sense, rank relation will give you a number. That's why we chose for this so far. But we definitely are doing more. We are definitely going to do more.
Yes, please.
Questions on that?
This divergent, what happens with Pearson coefficient for networks with first, second, third moment divergent? It's actually it's trivial, yes. But more interesting, what happens with the value of Pearson coefficient? It's strangely dependent on the fact if your graph is tree or not tree. Our claim was just the most beautiful claim, actually, was the following. If you have a recursively growing tree, suppose that it grows with a preferential attachment mechanism, and preferential attachment is linear with arbitrary degree distribution exponent. It can be 2.5, and can be 1,000, and for three, for this tree, strangely, Pearson coefficient is exactly zero.
You computed this in this formula, yes.
And so that it's apparently all these claims, they may be different for trees. For mathematicians, I believe it's very beautiful, can be, at least a funny result. Exactly is zero for recursively growing trees.
Yes, that is indeed very curious, and this is what you see back here. That with coefficient A equals to 1 or M equals to 1, this will be 0. However, like in experiments, we didn't observe it. Why? Because this is still an asymptotic expression. This is still an asymptotic expression. But it is an interesting question where this comes from. But I believe there are more mechanisms driving your correlation coefficient to 0. Independence is one of them, and the heavy tails is another. So in configuration model and probably in this model also, both are at work. But the heavy tails always drive your Pearson coefficient to 0, even if there is a dependence.
Okay, maybe last question.
You wanted also to ask.
One last more questions. I can all
always ask my question.
Okay, then I'll give a preference to somebody who did not ask a question. Okay.
My question kind of general. So if you have some intuition, when we should care about assertivity and when we shouldn't. So in what type of problems, you know, assertivity could be important?
Yeah.
If you have some intuition. If not, I understand this. You worked on just mathematical framework, and my question is general. So if you don't have intuition, that's fine.
You mean when it can be important to know about correlations?
Yes.
Yeah, there are plenty of cases.
The question I was afraid to ask.
No, but why afraid? No. But it's important in many cases. For instance, I started with the Sabelin internet graph. So apparently it was proved that, so they analyzed the performance of internet on this graph. It was work by Doyle and Coffers, and they showed actually that, they're interested in performance, how fast and how efficient the data can be transferred. And apparently negative correlations, negative degree correlations, are good for efficient working of internet. Another thing that there was a work that also epidemic spread can be easily enforced or delayed depending on positive or negative correlations. So actually, yeah, I wouldn't say so because epidemic spread is not really determined by degree distribution. It is an important factor, but it's not determined. So it is still a question how to quantify this. But that wiring of the network is important for epidemic spread is a fact. So there are many cases where it is important. So these are just two examples. Yeah.
Perhaps this is a good coffee conversation that can be okay. resolved, but let's push off all the other questions for offline. And thanks, Lena, again.